At mga kaagapay, ngayon pong Friday morning, atin pong bibigyang pansin ang iba't ibang persecution po na nagaganap sa mga Kristiyano sa buong mundo. Makakasama po natin today ang Open Doors sa usaping ito at meron po silang isang gawain ngayong week, itong Never Alone na speaker tour kung saan binabahagi po nila ang kwento ng mga persecuted women at ini-encourage ang mga simbahan na mag-participate po, makilahok sa pag-suporta sa mga persecuted Christians. Tayo po ay blessed na makakasama ang speaker po ng napakagandang gawain ito sa pamumuno ng Open Doors. Nandito po ngayon live sa ating studio ng Oras na Pilipinas si Helen Fisher, ang Global Gender Persecution Specialist ng Open Doors International, at ibabahagi, ikwekwento po niya sa atin ngayon ang mga persecution na nagaganap po, particular na sa mga kababaihan sa iba't ibang panig po ng mundo na nangyayari po sa nakalipas ng ilang mga dekada. At ang kanyang focus bilang isang specialist ay ang kanyang kakaibang experience po, kakaibang experience din naman ng mga kalalakihan at kababaihan sa global community. So let us all welcome dito po sa Oras na Pilipinas si Ms. Helen Fisher, ang Global Gender Persecution Specialist ng Open Doors International. Good morning, Helen.
Good morning.
Welcome to Manila. Welcome to the Philippines.
Thank you so much. It's lovely to be here.
Mm-hmm. I heard this is your second time to visit our beautiful country.
It is, yes. Mm-hmm.
And the beautiful Filipino people.
It is. It's wonderful. And I've just been further north and discovering mm-hmm. other parts of the country. And I'm really enjoying my time here, meeting fantastic people in the churches.
Have you tasted our adobo?
I have, yes.
Oh. So, what can you say about it?
Delicious.
Thank you for visiting us. And we'll talk about the global persecution that is happening amongst Christians, especially among women. Can you share, based on your observations, what is the current situation of Christians around the world and what the Christians can do about it?
Mm. So it's quite a big question
yes.
right there. Yeah. So... persecution in the world, you know, we put out a list every year mm-hmm. of the 50 worst countries, and North Korea continues to top that list, mm-hmm. and followed by Afghanistan and Somalia. Mm-hmm. And we're seeing a rise in persecution, 245 million Christians persecuted around the world. And this... this is manifesting itself in kind of increasing ways. We see this in some ways on the news in mm-hmm. sub-Saharan Africa, hotspots like India, where there's rising national religious extremism. Mm-hmm. And all of these things we can catch glimpses of when we're paying attention to our news channels.
Mm-hmm. Can you cite some examples of pictures, what kind of persecutions they are experiencing in the mentioned countries?
So I'll just skip down the list a little bit more to one that we've really all seen in the news, which is happening in Nigeria. Mm-hmm. We've had a number of items in the news for the past 5 years since the Chibok kidnappings of the girls. And most recently, we've had the story of Leah Sharibu, who is a Christian girl who was kidnapped with 100 other girls. And yet she was the only one who was kept because she was a Christian who refused to say a prayer that was denying her faith in Jesus Christ. And this is actually typical of religious persecution. We'd like to think that this kidnapping of young women is something that is exceptional and that the targeting of them is exceptional, but it's actually increasingly typical of the sort of religious persecution that we're seeing of Christians.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Is there a difference when it comes to male and female persecution among Christians?
There is indeed. And we have had for the first time since 2018 mm-hmm. an actual study in order to tell us what the global trends are. And this is global trends for the 50 countries that Open Doors does research on mm-hmm. of the 50 worst countries. And we have been able to see that there are distinct global trends for men and for women. And the top three trends mm-hmm. are completely different for men and for women.
Mm-hmm. Can you mention the top
yes,
three, please?
Yes. So for men, it is focused on economic harassment mm-hmm. combined with shaming and shunning, and also physical violence, including torture. Mm-hmm. Whereas for women, it focuses around our physical purity and our family status. And so the top trend is sexual assault that does not include rape. The second is forced marriage and targeted seduction. And the third one is, unfortunately, rape. And those are the most common trends around the globe.
Mm-hmm. That's really sad.
Uh-huh. It's very hard to hear this, isn't it? It's very hard for us to realize as a Christian body that this is the way our brothers and sisters are being attacked and coerced to change their faith and deny Jesus.
And I would like to speak to our mga kaagapay because nakaka-shock ano yung mga kwento sa atin ni Helen, mga kaagapay, kasi dito sa Pilipinas talagang we experience freedom in our religious expression. Kaya yung mga sinasabi po ni Helen na yung ibang mga Christians in other parts of the world na to the point na nare-rape sila dahil sa kanilang belief sa ating Panginoong Jesus, talagang sa atin parang ang layo-layo po ng ating karanasan. Kaya dapat na pahalagahan po natin itong kalayaan pagdating po sa pagpapahayag po ng ating pananampalataya sa ating Panginoon. So Helen, can you tell us more? What are the common effects and implications of gender-based persecution?
Well, it's never actually about the individual. Of course, it's the individual who suffers the things that I've been talking about, whether it's economic harassment for the men or sexual assault for the women. But we are targeted as individuals in this way because of the impact it has on our families, because of the impact it has on our communities. Mm-hmm. So just to give you an example, I've spent a certain amount of time in Central African Republic. And there, when the women are targeted, it is understood to bring shame upon their families. And so it breaks the family apart when the daughters and the mothers are attacked in this way. Mm. And very often it divides the family and it causes the entire community to fall apart. And so it really is a targeting of those relationships that are fundamental to not just our health as a church, but also just reflecting who we are as the image of God in the community around us. So it's a very fundamental attack on God himself rather than just us as individuals.
So how those victims, Christian victims, responded after they experienced harassment or persecution?
Yes, and it always goes in phases, the responses. There's always an initial, very often initial, just pain and hurt phase, and then questioning of God. And then it depends so much on the individual, and it depends so much on the community that they find themselves on. So this is where we find out where a person's faith is really anchored. And we have some people who will just say, Lord, you know, before this happened, my life was yours. And now that this has happened, my life still belongs to you. And then there are others. It is, isn't it? It's just an incredible testimony to that faith in their Heavenly Father. And then there are others who respond by saying, but Lord, where were you in this? And when that happens, it's so important, our response as a Christian community, because when we come around that person as a healing body, as an affirming body, then actually we are the ones who essentially say to them, your Father is a loving Father. And then they're able to, very often through our trauma counseling and through other groups where we put the person back on their feet and restore them in their identity, that is when our brother or sister says, you know, God did this. God allowed this. God never does this. Sorry. God allowed this so that we could see manifest the fact that we are one body. And now I'm no longer afraid of what will happen to me because I know my God is there with me no matter what happens.
So most of them stood firm on their faith.
Yes. So we see a lot of them standing firm. And you know, even when we see that actually somebody just is not able to stand firm, we remember Peter. You know, Jesus told Peter at the table, he said, you will deny me three times. And Peter, of course, said, well, no, Lord, of course not. And then we know several hours later, in fact, he did. And yes, he wept bitterly at knowing that he was not willing to, in that moment, make that sacrifice of his life for Jesus. But Jesus restored him. Jesus forgave him. and Jesus reestablished him as the leader of the church. And that is also the hope that we can bring to our brothers and sisters who, in a particular moment, were not able to stand firm like they wanted to, so that they will go on in the future to stand for Jesus.
So you, in Open Doors, how do you support them?
So the way we support our brothers and sisters depends on their particular needs. We were just talking about the difference between the way men and women are persecuted.
Yes.
So we need to look at what their needs are. We need to look at what their experience is. And so, of course, both need spiritual support, but actually physically as well. If our brothers and sisters are being attacked in their economic situation, then if we can empower them with livelihood training, with microloans, if we can come alongside those who have been attacked with trauma counseling, and sometimes it begins with literacy so that they can read the Word of God and be directly encouraged from the Word themselves. So there's an entire range of practical things that we can do for our brothers and sisters according to where they are under pressure for their faith.
Do you have figures of how many Christians are persecuted around the world?
So this year we estimate that it's 245 million Christians around the world are experiencing some form of persecution.
That's a lot. 240 million.
Yeah. It really is. It's a vast number, and it's really beyond our contemplation. But I think that's a challenge to us to step out of our free expression of faith and say, you know, what I have as a freedom, I should not take for granted. Because if I look at the facts, that's not actually the situation for a lot of my brothers and sisters around the world. So it's a challenge to us to say, okay, I need to take those facts and I need to understand that they are reality.
With that, Helen, how do Christians must respond, or what ways we could do to be of help to the persecuted Christians?
Yes, it is. When we hear these things, we want to help, don't we? And so one of the first things is to become more informed. We need to learn more. And so I would encourage you, especially your listeners in the Philippines, to go onto Facebook and look for Open Doors PH, or go online to opendoors.ph and find out more about our brothers and sisters. Because the more we know, the more specific we are in our prayers. And those websites will also tell you how you can get involved in supporting some of those practical projects and understanding what some of those practical projects are. I would very much encourage you also to not be afraid of persecution, not be afraid of those who would come against us. We have the promise in Deuteronomy 31:6 that God says, do not be afraid or terrified because of them, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And so we can also take the testimonies of our brothers and sisters and be encouraged by them instead of being afraid of possibly here being under pressure for our faith, or even just experiencing suffering. They're very encouraging stories for us to know of.
That's very encouraging. So, mga kaagapay, kailangan po nating i-add and i-follow ang Open Doors sa kanila pong Facebook page na Open Doors PH, para po balitaan natin at masubaybayan po natin kung ano yung mga karanasan, ano yung mga ginagawa ng atin pong mga kapwa mananampalataya. Hindi man kakulay ng ating balat, pero kapatid po natin sa Panginoon na talaga naman pong nalalagay sa panganib at sa hamon po ang kanilang buhay dahil po sa tawag ng pananampalataya. And Helen, can you, for the last message, can you give us a message of hope for our Filipino people?
Yes.
You know, we have a different kind of persecutions here in our nation.
Yes. So I mentioned Leah Sharibu earlier, and just a couple of months ago, I was in Nigeria and talking to her best friend, and asking what kind of encouragements that they had as they waited from her. And they really looked at Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, who said, you know, my God is powerful to save us. But, you know, even if he doesn't save us, we will not bow down to these idols. We will not worship others. And I think that testimony of faith is something that can be an example for us. And she also said, well, her hope comes from Isaiah 61, which says that actually our mourning will be replaced mm-hmm. by the oil of gladness, and to know that one day every tear will be wiped away and death will be no more. So that very long-term view, to know that God never intended suffering, and actually he will restore us completely, and we have the hope of heaven ahead of us, mm-hmm. is something that we can always cling to.
That's our blessed assurance, isn't it?
Yes, it is indeed.
And some of our friends from Open Doors PH commented on our Facebook page that we can also download your prayer magazine, okay, at www.opendoors.ph.
Indeed, and I encourage you to do so. It has a daily prayer guide with prayer topics in there for you. So we don't have to wonder what to pray for, but we can all join together on the same day praying for a particular topic.
Mm-hmm. And before I let you go, Miss Helen, yes. I would like you to invite our kaagapais here in Oras na Pilipinas in this ongoing Never Alone na speaker tour. Can you tell us more about this?
Well, we are going into a number of churches. We'll have tomorrow talking, because it's International Widows Day, that is this weekend. And so going and speaking there together and sharing about the widows of the persecuted church and how God is walking with them. And then we'll be speaking in churches all day on Sunday. Mm-hmm. So it is a time for us to come together and say, what does this message mean for the Philippines? What does it mean for us here? And how can people get involved?
Mm-hmm. So maybe we can visit your Facebook page, the Open Doors PH Facebook page, for the detailed and the specifics of this ongoing seminars with
yes,
you.
Yes, please do.
Thank you so much, Ms. Helen, and it's our pleasure to have you in the show.
It's been a joy. Thank you so much for having us.
God bless you. Mga kaibigan, nakausap po natin si Ms. Helen Fisher ng Global Gender Persecution Specialist ng Open Doors International, at sila po ay patuloy na nagsasagawa po nitong Never Alone na speaker tour hanggang June 23 pa po. At para po sa mga detalye po ng kanilang mga napakagandang gawain, and of course, ito po ay eye-opener, diba? Para po sa bawat isa sa atin na hindi lang po natin aalalahanin yung personal walk po natin sa ating Panginoon. Kung hindi in our prayer times, ayan, personal man yan, or sa ating mga prayer meeting in our churches, alalahanin po natin yung ibang mga kapwa natin mananampalataya na nandoon po sa panganib yung kanilang pong buhay, sampu ng kanilang mga mahal sa buhay dahil po sa kanilang pananampalataya sa atin pong Panginoong Jesus. So once again, let us add them sa kanila pong Facebook page, Open Doors PH. Magbabalik po ang Oras na Pilipinas. Makakasama muna natin ngayon ang ating kaagapay para po sa ating mabati ang mabuti at maitama ang mali.